Lightning McQueen. What's poppin', internet? Welcome to another episode of the Synced Up Filmcast, a show where we reel you into Disney movies and talk about the things that we've been watching. This is take two.
Number take two.
Had an emergency call. I'm one of your hosts, Timothy DeRose. Joining me this week is your boy, Michael Clare. That sucks because I had the ASMR water pour on there.
No, you didn't.
I did.
What?
Yeah, I did while you were talking.
I thought that was last week.
No, I tried last week and it didn't work. I tried it yesterday and it didn't work.
You saved the water bottle just for the intro?
Yeah, I was like, I'll pour it fresh cup.
Yeah, I mean, you might be able to cut it in. I think we recorded that footage.
Mm-hmm.
It might be dry ass footage, but
yeah. You
might still have it.
Yeah, anyway.
It's been a busy week.
Yep, today we're going to rank Encanto.
Encanto.
Talk about a little Hawkeye action.
Hawkeye.
There's currently nobody on the sticks.
Maybe that's it.
There's nobody on the ones and twos right now because spoilers.
This place might burn down.
It's big spoilers.
Yeah,
big
Jordan spoilers. Hasn't seen either shows, but yep. he wants to.
He'll be back for the post show, and he'll be back to slot it in where we end up ranking
it.
We'll have to look at the list on our phone. We have nobody. So sorry for no visual on the visual.
We got version. Jill, though.
We do got Jill. Hold it down,
Jim. Resident dog.
Anyway, before we get into that, a little bit of housekeeping for you. If you enjoy this show, if you like any portion of it, we're on 51. We're on 43 out of 51 Disney movies. 51 Disney movies we've watched and ranked. So if you enjoy that, that's a lot of content we put out. If you like that, if you like any of it at any time, you should consider going to patreon.com/syncedup, where for $1 you can get access to our lovely Discord and vote on what we do next. Which franchise? Illumination?
It's coming soon.
DreamWorks?
Not Illumination.
It's gonna.
You just want to watch Sing.
It's fan voted. No, I mean Illumination is the good stuff. You know.
You just want to watch Sing.
Fast and Furious, Harry Potter.
A
lot of good options in there. Transformers. If you don't want us to watch some bullshit and you want us to watch what you want to watch, consider going to patreon.com/syncedup and pay us $1 one time, and you're
$1.
In there forever. Over $5, you get access to all of that, plus the post shows of both the shows that we do and many more goodies, all from youtube.com/syncedup podcast and podcasting services around the globe.
The globe.
New episodes of this show specifically go up in all of those feeds Tuesdays, 7 a.m.
Central time zone. Gang.
I wanted to say Central a.m.
Central?
Was, yeah, I was going to say Central a.m. That's why I paused there for a
central
second.
Central a.m.
Anyway, you should also write into the show to syncedupod@gmail.com or the reader mail submissions tab of that, their Discord, which is a lot easier if you just pay us $1. And we may read those questions, comments, or concerns on the show. Because it's empty. We got nothing this week. Again, you know how it goes on the Filmcast.
You don't even got to write in about the show. Just tell me how your day was.
Exactly. We'll read that shit.
I'll read it.
We'll read that shit
for
sure.
We'll commentate your day.
It's okay, though. It was Thanksgiving week, so I'm not mad at y'all. We still love you.
I'm pissed. I'm living.
You should also consider dropping a follow at SyncedUpPod on Twitter.
Twitter.
Do that.
Lower thirds.
We can't hit those lower thirds.
Nah, not today.
Not today. So let's just jump right in.
So this is the 60th, because if you go see the movie, it'll say the 60th Disney animation film. And this is your reminder that we're not watching all 60 Disney animation films.
We skipped the, I'm getting another call. We skipped 9 of the live action cross animation movies.
Do you need to answer this one?
Dude, I don't know.
Go for it.
Vamp real quick. I'm just going to answer it and then.
Go ahead. So something I didn't realize. Maybe I'm misremembering. I don't remember Disney animation doing.
All right, hold it down for 2 minutes.
2 minutes? All
two
right.
minutes. Van for 2 minutes. All right. Do that? I can start again.
Okay. I'm going to talk about the featurette. All right. You can talk about it when you come back. So I don't remember Disney doing little featurettes before the movie starts, its own individual small film, short film. I know Pixar does it. They got the classics ones with the chess guy, the birds. I think the most recent one I remember was the little. What are they called? The little buns, steamed buns. They did a little short about that. But this one was about kind of like parenting, told through the story of like three generations of raccoons, which was a very interesting way to tell the story. But it spoilers, I guess, for this little raccoon film. It's basically just how fears can easily decide parenting styles, right? So this one raccoon is scared of their child exploring anything because of all the dangers. And so this child's curious and gets himself into more and more danger because the parent isn't willing to really show the child anything out of fear. And so that child grows up, starts raising his own raccoon, right? And then you kind of have to, you start to see like where the raccoon starts to repeat the bad parenting almost of their parent raccoon. And then they start to realize, like, no, maybe it's better if I teach my child about these scarier things than just keeping them away from it. And it leads to a better connection between, or better relationship between the child raccoon and the parent raccoon. The child raccoon is you know, in less trouble technically, because they have a better understanding of like what the dangers are, what to look out for, instead of just not being able to do anything. And clearly it's a very literal metaphor for how we raise children and how we're taught to you know, discipline and keep these things that are dangerous away from our children.
Sorry to do that.
So I basically I explained the plot for the little raccoon movie at the beginning.
Okay, yeah, that was good. I like that.
And it's
really
good. I basically just said it's a metaphor for how we raise children. Yeah. And how if you keep
perpetuate the problem.
Yeah, if you just teach fear and never like actually teach your children anything about these problems, then they'll
grow up.
The curiosity will end up hurting them more than the understanding will.
Yeah, exactly. Which is how he showed, you know, in the end, he was like, hey, you're curious, but actually, instead of being an asshole, I'm going to take you up in this tree and show you why.
This is why you don't want to mess around.
Exactly.
But I'll still show you around and teach you these things. And it leads to a better relationship between the parents.
It was a good little short film at the beginning.
And I didn't remember Disney doing that. No. Disney animation themselves.
It's Pixar. But it's been a while since I've seen a Disney movie in theaters.
Right.
I don't remember. No, we didn't watch it in theaters.
Oh, I guess we didn't watch it here.
And we watched Frozen 2, and I don't think they did it for
But that was the bun one, the steam bun one, right? It was like the bun that grew up to be a child.
Oh, I think you're right. The steam bun. So maybe they have been doing it for a while.
I
just in theaters.
Was that Frozen 2 or was it? What was the most recent Pixar film?
The most recent Pixar film would have been Toy Story 4?
No. That can't be right. They've had to do one more recently than
that. Can't be right.
What's the most recent Pixar film? Pixar movies. Cars. Soul.
Soul.
Was it Soul?
Yeah, I think Soul had that.
Or was it Coco? I think it's Soul.
Yeah. Who knows?
But I remember seeing it in theaters. Was it Luca?
We watched Luca here.
I don't know, man. I don't remember what that was in, but
yeah,
it was a good little small film at the beginning
of
the film.
I enjoyed it. I enjoyed it as well. But now onto the bread and butter.
The meat.
Here's a little summary. Here's what we're going to do. I'm going to give you the summary of Encanto.
As of like Wikipedia?
Yeah.
Or like front
then
page?
We're going to rank it, and then we're going to talk about it.
Why? You got to bring Jordan back to rank it?
No. We'll just, because remember, Jordan's not going to be in here. So we're gonna look at the list.
So what you're saying is you don't need to see the list to know where you're ranking
it. Well, we can pull the list up on our phone. But yeah, I don't need to see it.
Okay,
sure.
Yeah,
anyway,
reply.
Anyway, but I need to bring up the list so I can tell the people the list. Anyway, so Encanto. The Madrigals are an extraordinary family who live in the hidden mountains of Colombia in a charmed place called the Encanto. The magic of the Encanto has blessed every child in the family with a unique gift, every child except Mirabel. However, she soon may be the Madrigals' last hope when she discovers that the magic surrounding the Encanto is now in danger. So that's the plot synopsis.
Good movie. Music clearly done by Lin-Manuel.
Yeah, it's cool.
If you've seen any of his musicals, you can tell it's his style of writing songs.
Yeah.
This was a fantastic movie. Yep. I guess, well, you want to rank it right now?
Mm-hmm. Okay. So the list, the top
five. I feel
like
it's kind of weird.
It's in the top. Well, I know, but I just wanted to do this a little experiment. Anyway, five. Well, do the top five because I assume it's in the top five.
Yeah.
Okay. So top five, The Hunchback at Notre Dame.
At number five.
The Lion King.
Four.
Treasure Planet.
Three.
Tarzan.
Two.
Lilo and Stitch.
Number one, baby.
Yeah. So where do you place?
You want a countdown or you just
asking
me?
Yeah, we'll do a countdown. Ready? All
right.
Three, two, one. I put it at two.
Okay.
I have a cut. Now, this is the reason I wanted this is the reason I wanted to do this experiment.
Really?
Because I have a couple of reasons. I wanted to state my reasons why I put it for number two after I told you I put it in number two. Which is the reason why I wanted to do this.
Okay.
So,
I'm a little hurt.
You are a little hurt? That's fair. There's
a clear reason why it's number one for me.
Yeah. And?
Okay, so the reason I like Lilo and Stitch is because it's like the first Disney film where it's like, this is
relatable.
Human. It's relatable. This is a family dynamic between, even though it's just two sisters and an alien, there's clearly human family dynamics here.
Mm-hmm.
That just gets put up to 1,000 in Encanto because they're actual human. Like, it's a huge family, and that's what I like, is just that that family is the main focus of the movie. And that's exactly what I love in Lilo and Stitch. So it's not like Lilo and Stitch has the head there. Mm-hmm. The animation, just better in Encanto. Now, the charm, I think there's something charming about the older 2D animation style of Lilo and Stitch. Mm-hmm. Encanto, the animation doesn't do anything new. And that's what I've talked about before, where all the Disney movies start to look the same from like Tangled forward. You're not getting like, oh, wow, this animation is truly crazy. Something I've never seen before.
You're not getting any leaps and bounds in technological
sense. It's not anything crazy new.
Yeah.
So it doesn't do anything there, even though it's still a stunning, beautiful movie. Everything looks great.
Yep.
It's very colorful. I like that a lot. I love the music.
That's great.
I love Lin-Manuel stuff in general. So,
tip, of course.
Pop. Just in general, I wanted to cry the whole movie. And I can't. It's so weird. We started watching the movie. And, like, I started to have this feeling swell up in me immediately.
Yeah.
When you start getting into some of the family dynamics, where you're like, oh, there's a little tension between grandma and, you know, our main character here. And like, there's some kind of sister tension as well. This is like a normal family where not everything's perfect.
I'm getting another call. I can't answer this one. Moving on.
And I immediately, I was like, okay, there's a lot of human emotions that are going to be present in this film. Mm-hmm. And then the last 30 minutes, I'm crying.
Yeah.
The whole time. Lilo and Stitch doesn't do that to me.
Yeah.
There's no way I could see me putting Lilo and Stitch above this.
Mm-hmm.
But you can explain why you did.
Okay, so I have two. There's one minor nitpicky reason and one reason that to me is major. And it took away my enjoyment of towards the ending of the film. Same really? With Noah. I concurred this with Noah because I said it when we left the theater and he was like, no, I was thinking the exact same thing.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I went and watched the movie twice because I was like, maybe that won't be a problem on the second viewing. Watching it a second time, I felt the same exact way and I was like, man, that bums me out.
Mm-hmm.
Sorry. I'm getting text messages. There is a very quick turnaround on Abuela. Abuela goes from going in on Mirabelle to less than 3 to 4 minutes later, they're hugging and they're good. And there, to me, there was not enough that happens in that in-between time to make it feel genuine. To me, it's like this. I feel like there needs to be 10 more minutes of movie for something to happen to give Abuela the true dynamic like thing to happen to her.
I disagree.
That makes, because nothing happens.
Well, no. You're wrong.
An asshole. The house falls down, and then all you get is her little flashback, and that's it.
No, you're wrong. Because the whole time Mirabelle is popping off on her,
mm-hmm.
and he's like, "You're the reason. You're the problem here, and you need to see that." And then you look around, see the whole house is down, and then Abuela. That's when that realization hits. Like, I've lost the one thing I was trying to defend because I didn't realize I was supposed to be protecting around me, not the building.
That's just not, I don't believe it. It's not believable.
Why?
Because
Abuela's not set out to be like a villain. So
no,
it's
I know
not
she's
like
not set out
like,
to be a villain, but she, like, it's not believable in the sense because she has like this set way and she's had it the whole movie and she's like a stickler and an asshole the whole movie. And in this one moment, The
I don't
kid,
think she's an asshole though.
But she kind
of
is,
because she's trying to protect hundreds of people.
Yeah,
and keep this community alive.
Exactly, but she does it in an asshole. She's being an asshole to Mirabelle, like she is in the movie. She
yeah,
kind of. Even the mom is like, you're way too hard on Mirabelle.
She's being ass.
You're being way too hard on Mirabelle.
But I don't think it's that crazy for her to like turn around.
When it goes to the point where they're sitting on the river, I'm like, okay, we're gonna have a moment. And then Abuela's like, oh yeah, like, you know, it was kind of my fault. And I was like, okay. But then Mirabelle's like, no, but you're actually great. And I was like, no, fuck that.
No, but she is.
No, she was being such a
bitch. Everything she's done was to protect her family.
Everything she was done was to protect the candle and the gifts up until that point. And she even says that to herself that I...
Because that's what protects her family.
No.
Yes.
No.
Yes.
She, but okay, but she doesn't care about her whole family because she, up in that whole movie, she didn't care about Mirabelle and she wanted her in the background because she didn't have a magical gift. The whole movie, she says, get out of the way. Stay mm-hmm. in the back. Don't talk.
Because all that's on her mind is, as the matriarch, protecting her family.
Yeah, except
and Mirabelle
for the one
is
who
not,
doesn't have a gift.
And she can't see at the moment that Mirabelle, who is contributing to this family, she can't see that.
Yeah, so she's...
At the end, she realizes...
She only cares
I'm
about protecting
up.
About her family that has magical gifts. She doesn't care about protecting the other portion
she's,
of her family.
She cares about protecting the whole village. She cares about protecting Mirabelle. She doesn't care about her feelings necessarily.
Yeah, and then there's other things too where like with her like forcing old girl to get married to one dude when she doesn't want to and just stuff like that, which I know that's like her cultural things.
Mm-hmm.
But to me, the swiftness at which Abuela it like comes back and then Mirabelle just instantly forgives her. I'm like, this is it doesn't feel believable to me. It feels way too fast. And then the reason I said it tainted the rest of the movie is because the song that happens after that, all of me song, which is like a really good mm-hmm. Like personal enjoyable moment, get like the whole time I'm sitting there thinking like, no, why the Abuela, there needs to be more, because I'm still pissed at Abuela as a viewer. I'm still pissed at her and this wasn't enough to get me to be like, yeah, like, I forgive you. Like, I still felt like...
I don't know. No. I turn around on, like, the perfect sister in, like, 30 seconds.
Yeah, because you realize that the perfect sister, her powers wasn't actually being perfect. She just kept it up as an image to protect the family. So you realize that...
Abuela isn't... Like, none of them aren't doing anything inherently wrong. Like, they're just doing what they think they need to do for their family.
I feel like what Abuela is doing,
Abuela's job is to be an ass, she doesn't care.
I feel like Abuela's does do stuff inherently wrong by ousting her grandkid because she doesn't have magical powers. And she has no reason to do so because she never seen his vision. So she doesn't know that she's in the vision of the magic going away. She mm-hmm. never seen Bruno's vision. She never seen any of that. So when you turn the clock back and you also think, okay, so she had to have been like this for like the last 13 years or the last like 12 years or however long it's been since the door incident. So she's been an ass this whole time. And we just turn around at the end when you get Mirabelle in like a fourth wall breaking type of thing, see her past and then be like, oh, actually, because you had a bad past, it's okay that you were an asshole to me. Like, it's not enough for me to forgive Abuela. Now, that being said, that's only the very, very end. And that's my only like big problem mm-hmm. is that. And that doesn't take away, like, I still love this movie. I think this movie's fantastic. I think all the songs are great. I think all the characters are so fleshed out and like so realized mm-hmm. and great. I like them all. I think every single song hits. Every single song bangs. The Dos Orojitas, the Spanish song was good. Every single one of the sister songs was good. The Bruno song was great. Incorporating mm-hmm. every family member with their own little, like, let's change the song. We're not just gonna make this one like song. We're gonna like change the beat up. When the hearing girl, I can't remember her name, comes in. When she's like doing like a rap,
a little hip hop drop.
We're bringing it in. And
yeah, it's wonderful.
That shit's hot. And then all the visuals are just crazy. Like, let's go. Let's start a song. Let's throw out the continuity and let's just do crazy shit with the visuals.
Yeah.
Let's just do crazy shit. We're going to have the Titanic show up. We're going
to
have servers.
That's what
show
you
up.
Need to do, because with animation, if you didn't do that, this movie sucks. Because you need to utilize the animation to your
advantage. Also, I appreciate the intro and being a weird fourth wall breaking. She's telling the kids about the
family.
Yeah,
everything you
need
to know
about
the family.
But also just telling you. Like, she's really just telling you.
Yeah.
But like, and she's like looking at the thing. And that song's really good. When she starts going really mm-hmm. fast, it's like, oh shit, we're getting a little
groovy. And near the end when they start teasing her about like, what's your power?
What about Mirabelle?
It gets really funny.
Yeah, it's really funny.
I can't believe you still put it at number two.
I just can't, because that grandma thing, it like genuinely towards the end, I like,
bro,
all
at
I
the end,
about,
like, they're about to.
It's all I can think
they're
about.
They're about to take Stitch home.
Yeah.
That's like the whole goal, the whole movie. And then she's like, you got a pet certificate.
Well, yeah, that's like a completely different thing.
She flips real quick.
Yeah, we're talking about aliens in a weird thing. This is supposed to be, it's not grounded, but it is grounded in a sense.
I don't know, bro. I think you putting it at number two is just so ridiculous.
I think we'll have to wait until Jordan watches
crazy,
it and see where he wants to
dude.
Put it. And to officially put it at either one or
that
number
movie,
two.
That movie.
No, we're not going to rank it until Jordan watches it so he can do the tiebreaker of whether it's number one or number two. But it's just that. And then the other, like, more nitpicky thing. There's the scene in which the grandma, Abuela, is when Mirabelle is like, you know what? Something's going on with the magic. I'm going to go check out the candle, right?
Yeah, she's on the roof.
She runs up, and she gets up on the roof, and she goes like this. Mm-hmm. Abuela says, if only they knew how vulnerable we really are, which is one of two things. That means she knows that the magic is falling away and why the magic is falling away and is an mm-hmm. asshole anyway, or she just shouldn't have said that because she doesn't know. So
no, I think
she
she's saying
about?
That as humans. Like, we're still humans.
I don't think so. Because she's asking for, like, to save, like, the miracle and stuff. And she's like, if only they knew
how vulnerable
we really are.
Because the idea of, like, this is me getting a little, taking a little liberty here, right?
Yeah.
Her whole thing is she was experiencing family and home and safety. And that got taken away from her violently.
Yeah.
Something, and at that point, you realize, we are so vulnerable. We don't have nearly as much protection as we think we do,
but they do. They're in the Encanto. Though there's a
but
literal
you're still
mountains.
Humans.
Yeah, but there's literal mountains around them, and they live in a utopia.
And you have hundreds of people depending on you, though.
But they live in a utopia.
Yeah,
like it's a magical
but a utopia.
Utopia
that's all dependent on you.
I don't. I just. It doesn't. I don't know. It doesn't.
And like clearly, she has some understanding of like the Encanto is only the Encanto as long as the candle. And the powers still exist.
Yeah, but she doesn't believe. She hasn't seen that the power is fading. Up until that point, she hasn't seen it. She didn't see
that's,
the tracks.
Well, no, but I think she believes Mirabelle to a point.
I don't know.
Because she's the only reason she said what she said at the party was to calm down the nerves of the people in the town, right?
Yeah, but then when they go to talk about like Lisa and the magic fading, even if Abuela does believe that the magic is fading, she blames it on Mirabelle and. in that instance because she's like, why did you go talk to Lisa? Like, you're causing her power. She's like, I felt weak. And she's like, what did you do? This is your fault. Go stay on the side. She just jumps to that conclusion.
Yeah, because she's being an ass about that.
I don't know.
But I think the candle thing is totally justified.
Like, I don't know. It just,
she, I bet she understands that there is some waning in the power.
Yeah, it just feels a little weird and out of place. Just a little odd and out of place.
I don't know. I think it's easily number one.
Yeah, I don't know. This was the thing I was talking. I don't know if I talked about it in the Discord where I was struggling if I wanted to put it in one place or the other. I spent a long time thinking about whether I wanted it to be above Lilo and Stitch or below, because it definitely has the shot to be above Lilo and Stitch for sure. We'll see about like Moana and Frozen 2 and all those movies. But it was the specific thing about it feeling way too fast on the grandma's turnaround is what officially like made me be like, okay, I can't just put it at number one, because I didn't have any critiques of Lilo and Stitch. I didn't have like anything bad to say. I had sure like the enjoyment was higher in points of Encanto, and it was a great movie. And I got the soundtrack saved. I don't got the Lilo and Stitch soundtrack saved, but it's just that quick turnaround on the grandma just felt so fast, and I was just like, man, I cannot believe this. Like,
I think the problem quick. Though is that this movie is 100% human family. Like, that's what the movie is. It's about humans. Family, mm-hmm. the emotions and the things and, that get started up with human and family.
Maybe
Lilo and Stitch, while it's a human film, is clearly also very taken way away from like a real human life, because there's aliens, there's so much other stuff going on.
Maybe it's just the fact that I would, because I'm a lot different when it comes to most people in terms of their family and like what levels of things you'll forgive people for.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe it's just me and Noah being sticklers and being like, there's no fucking way I would hug a boy after she pulled that shit, because I would not. I'd be like, go fuck yourself. I'm at the river. I'm chilling. Go do your own thing, lady. You was being a complete ass. You've been a complete ass for weeks. I'm not talking to you.
So yeah, you that might just be you.
Yeah, because I guess that's like my own little thing, because it feels like, because she sees the flashback and stuff, in my head, it's like Abuela shows up and is like, look, my life sucks, so that's why I treated you like shit. It's like, no, fuck you. I couldn't do it. I was mad. But the rest of that movie is great.
I don't think she's saying her life sucks. I think she's saying...
She's not saying that, but...
I care about what we have.
That's like portrayed, because she...
And in my blind... I was blinded by, you know, trying to protect what we have.
It's me...
I overlooked taking care of the things that I needed to take care of.
It's me being a little meta, because she doesn't overtly say that, like, my life sucked, but, like, it's the assumption, because she's...
I don't think she's trying to make her feel guilty or anything. She's confessing, like, this is... I was blind.
Yeah, but it's the placement of the flashbacks as me being like meta of the my life sucks.
Yeah, sure.
But she's not overtly saying it. It's just the placement of the flashbacks felt like Abuela's life sucks, so this is why you as an audience should forgive her in this moment. And that's what it kind of feels like. And it feels a little...
Well, no, because that's not a new concept. That's not like something like, oh, wow, I didn't know this about Abuela. We learned that at the front.
Yeah.
It's nothing like that. It's just like...
But you get a little more in-depth into it.
You do, but I don't think it's like...
It just... To me personally... The forgiveness and the redemption of Abuela does not feel earned.
I don't think it says anything about Abuela. I think it says you're focusing on Abuela in that moment, and I don't think that moment is necessarily about her. It's showing that Maribel, who doesn't have a power, her power is truly being the one that cares about her family.
Well,
she's what holds that family together.
Yeah,
she's the one that's going
to
forgive
to me in that moment
more than anybody else.
Exactly. But in my moment, in the moment,
you're so frustrated at Abuela.
Yeah, that I can't. That I'm like,
you couldn't imagine being Maribel in that.
Yeah. I was like, don't.
Which
forgive
I can't
her.
Be her either. She is the character that Maribel is portrayed as is like a very, I care so much about each and every one of you. Mm-hmm. The way she talks to Lisa, the way she talks to Antonio at the beginning, taking care of him. She is so.
Lisa's great.
That's clearly her power, is the being the. The rock of the family.
Mm-hmm.
So she's not going to be on Abuela's shit like we would be.
Yeah, I would have been on her ass for a while.
That's just part of her character.
Yeah. Anyway.
I don't know.
So there you go.
I'm trying to talk you up to number one.
No, it's not happening.
It's so good, dude.
I'm sorry. It's a great film. It's fantastic. Everyone should go and watch it. If you haven't yet, it's definitely worth watching.
Better than Lilo and Stitch.
We'll see what happens if Jordan puts it at number one or number two. He'll be the tiebreaker next week.
Does Jordan like Lilo and Stitch like that?
I don't know.
I don't remember.
But I don't know. I don't know if he'll like Encanto, because he might put Encanto like 4 or some shit.
I hope not.
But I hope not too. I'd be offended. I think that movie's great. We'll see what happens in the future though, because you know, I still think Frozen 2, Moana. We'll have to see how those compare to to Encanto. And then, of course, once we hit the 50 mark, we'll go back and we'll readjust. And maybe our feelings have changed on the film. Maybe I like it more.
So there's
going to
be one movie left when we adjust?
No. Those, no.
What? You said there's 51 movies, right?
Yeah, but the last week we'll do number 50 and 51 because of the way we did it.
No, it'd be 50. You do 49. Oh, I guess
no, because
you're right.
We're
in
an odd right now.
We did one. Yeah, you're right.
Because we'll still do 2, 2, 2, and 2.
We should just wait the extra week and just readjust it at the end.
Yeah, maybe. Or, yeah. Maybe we go in, we reflect on the list, and announce what we're going to do the week next. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So instead of being like, hey, we're going to watch this and this, we're going to be like, all right, hey, next week we're going to reflect, we're going to change things, and then we'll announce what we're going to do.
Yeah.
That's a little behind the scenes. But baseball, third baseball? Behind baseball?
Behind
what's
the
scenes? Phrase? But it's like behind the scenes, but you say inside baseball. A little inside baseball.
Who says that?
You never heard that phrase?
No.
Yeah, that's like a phrase that means like behind the scenes. That's a little inside baseball.
Who says that, though?
They say it all the time. It's kind of funny. Like, oh, okay. That's a little inside baseball for you.
Okay.
Yeah, like, oh, sure. How do you guys run the shows? How do you divvy up the responsibility? Oh, let's get a little inside baseball.
Okay.
I don't know where that phrase comes from. I'm kind of curious.
Probably baseball.
Probably. Anyway, there's no real news this week and no real trailers this week, so we got nothing for you. Hope the Encanto talk was enough.
Nothing? They announced that there's going to be another trilogy of Spider-Man movies.
Yeah. Did they say trilogy or did they just say there's just more?
Everybody's putting it like it's another trilogy.
Yeah, people are saying three more films. I guess, yeah.
Yeah, we finished this three movies and now we're starting to think forward on the next three.
It's a little weird right now.
I think it's weird kind of how they work in trilogies
for
a lot of these movies.
Mm-hmm.
But
anyway.
Now you know Peter Parker's not going to die.
Spoilers. Yeah, of course. Other stuff that we've been watching, we watched Tick, Tick, Boom.
Tick, Tick, Boom. The Lin-Manuel Miranda directed film about Jonathan Larson.
Yeah, the rent guy.
Played by Andrew Garfield.
Wait, I thought it was really good.
I think it was really good, too.
I thought it was about an 8.
Yeah, I'd say that, too. It's not like... It's not, I think it's because of the music. It's not my favorite style of, like, musical
and the
numbers.
The storytelling is a little unconventional.
Yeah.
Not in a bad way.
I feel like once I did some research and, like, actually understood how it was presenting to me, or how it was being presented to me, it made more sense. Mm-hmm. Once I realized Tick, Tick, Boom was actually already a musical that Jonathan Larson himself wrote
about himself.
And yeah, I didn't understand that. I thought this was a movie about Jonathan Larson making a musical, which is what Tick, Tick, Boom is. Mm-hmm. It was just a weird thing that had to click for me. And then I started,
makes sense. It was really good. And Andrew Garfield did a great job.
Yeah, he learned to sing for that movie.
He did a great job.
I feel bad for the guy right now, though.
Yeah.
Because during all this press touring,
everybody's just trying to promote Spider-Man? This movie, and everyone's like, Spider-Man, though.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I feel bad for him. It was good, though. I recommend it.
Yep.
If you like Rent or it's not a Lin-Manuel feel to it.
Yeah.
But if you like the Jonathan Larson style of music, it's really good.
Mm-hmm.
I recommend.
Then, of course, we watched Hawkeye.
The
first two episodes of Hawkeye.
Both.
Of course, spoilers going forward into this.
Spoilers for Hawkeye.
I assumed everybody knew that it was spoilers for Encanto. I didn't say it before, but you guys get the gist.
Spoilers for every other movie we reviewed.
So. Yeah, so anyway, Hawkeye, the first two episodes. I actually really enjoyed this.
I did too.
Yeah, I was sitting here, I was watching it, so I go in to start it, and I was surprised. Maybe it's because my expectations were in the absolute shitter, like they were as low as they could possibly go. Not because I thought it would be bad, because I was like, it's Hawkeye, it's a Christmas show. I don't really give a fuck.
Yeah.
Like, I think it's really, really low. But I ended up watching it, and I was like, wait, actually, this is fun. This is great. Let's take a break from the cosmic scale of shit, which we're going to get back to in a couple of weeks with Spider-Man. But let's take a break from the cosmic scale of shit. Let's just chill on the fucking ground floor in New York City on Christmas, baby, with a couple of bow and arrows. And I'm digging it. There's a couple of things here. One of my favorite things that the MCU has started doing in the future, post-Infinity War, and even the beginning of Endgame, is the real life consequences that you see for the shit that has happened in those movies. That's my sauce. I love that
I
shit.
I agree to a point, but I feel like I also have a problem with it.
What?
Because while it's like, oh, these are the consequences of the Battle of New York in 2012.
Yeah.
It just doesn't make sense for me that the world is this functional after the snapback.
Well, we're way past the snapback. We're like 3 years past the snapback.
I know, but it's still just
because
seems
Falcon,
so
Falcon
weird,
and the Winter
bro.
Soldier was like, okay, the snap's still fucking things up because we're trying to get borders back.
Yeah,
we gotta fix that. We're like a little.
But that's not
past
like
that.
That's not solved at the end of Falcon and the Winter Soldier.
It is, bro. He comes down and he says, "Bro, y'all gotta stop doing."
He's
this.
Like, "I'm Captain America.
I'm Captain America."
That doesn't solve anything.
Yeah,
it's
no,
just
I
like.
Know, I know.
I just feel like it's
just,
so...
I feel like New York would be functional enough. I guess it's not super functional. I mean, there's a tracksuit mafia running around and nobody's doing anything about it.
I guess it's fair.
Homie's apartment building is getting burned down and he just comes out and he's like, hey, what are you doing?
To me, it's like all these crazy things have happened, right? But the thing that matters the most to the people of New York, Ronin.
Yeah.
Like, that was the biggest deal.
I guess, is it, I don't know, if, because what's happening right now on the grand scale? The Avengers are gone, everything's
broken. The Eternals.
The Eternals, that, I guess we got to know where the timeline is, right?
I don't know where Hawkeye happens, right?
Yeah.
The Eternals, that's a huge deal.
Wait, but, no. Mm-hmm. Well, all the people would have known from Eternals is there would have been some sightings of the Deviants, some sightings of the heroes, and then the big head in the hand. But there wasn't, like, anything groundbreaking that happened to the Earth.
And there's no, like, organizational, like, organized hero effort,
right? The Avengers
are
kind of, like, dissolved.
It's just so, it just feels weird, dude. Yeah. I can't explain it. Where it's wow, we're dealing with the consequences of the Battle of New York when the snap happened, like, 3 years prior.
Yeah.
Or the return snap.
Yeah.
Well, no, because it's not been 3 years.
It's been a couple of years.
Because the Battle of New York was 2021. So
no, Battle of New York was 2012.
2012. Yeah, my bad. You want to say
we're in like 2030 in the MCU because the snap happens. Then you get,
we're not in 2030.
Yeah, because the snap, because we're in line.
The snap.
Then the snap happens.
It's 5 years.
It's 5 years. And then it's been a little bit since the snap.
What year is it in the MCU?
Oh, no. What year is it in the MCU?
MCU. Ah, dude, I hate how the space bar gets small. 2024.
It's 2024. And that's for Hawkeye?
Yeah.
Oh. Oh, 2025.
For a period of time, we were going to set it 2 years out. So it's 2024.
Yeah, it's like a 2024, 2025 area.
I guess. So if you go, I don't know, man. This is...
So whenever Infinity War came out, well, it was 2018.
Yeah.
Then 5 years.
So it'd be 2023.
So, yeah.
It's 1 year after.
So we're 1 year
Know. I just feel like making such a big deal about it being, oh, we're dealing with the consequences.
But we are.
When the biggest consequence is not being addressed at all in this film.
What do you mean? Well, that's not what this film's
about. The snapback.
But that's not what
this film's
about.
I know.
And also, like...
But we have a musical.
Like, you still see it, like... Sure, but like when they come out, like if you pay attention, the streets are still run down as fuck, and there's like homeless people
everywhere.
But that's
just New York. That's New York.
Yeah, but sure, it looks really bad.
They're in New York City.
They are, but it looks really, really bad.
It's New York City.
I'm just saying. I don't know. It looks pretty bad.
You can't convince me, oh, it's bad because of the snap. Like, no, that's just New York City.
Black market people that retrieved items from the rubble of the war at the Avengers compound.
Yeah.
That shit makes sense. Of course that makes sense.
It's just like you draw... I feel like the biggest consequence is just not addressed. Like, I... Because it's like you're making a deal to address the consequences,
and it just doesn't feel... If we're a year and a half... Just think about how COVID went. COVID was a big fucking deal, and it's still affecting the world today, and we're a year and a half removed. Nobody's talking about it. Nobody's talking about it.
Hold up.
Nobody's talking about it.
I know we're comparing a fictional event and a real event.
Of course.
But
nobody's talking about it.
The fictional event is on a much...
I know.
Much larger scale.
But I'm just like, think about it, though. Like, we're 2 years past the snap back. So half the world... It's been 7 years since the fucking...
People still wear masks.
I mean, yes, sometimes. Not in our state.
Yeah, you go to the gas station, they're wearing masks.
A couple of people.
Workers are still wearing masks. I wear one at work.
Yeah,
I just feel like we're on this for a while.
Yeah.
It just doesn't feel like you're addressing to me what is like the proper consequence.
I feel like that has to be a different film, though.
You're right. Series. This is about Hawkeye.
Yeah. But also, so anyway, the other things that I was going to talk about in like the real world consequences.
Yeah, sorry.
Of course, seeing like the musical and stuff, that's like, okay, yeah, this shit makes sense. But seeing Hawkeye with PTSD. He sees Natasha Romanoff's person on the Broadway, and he starts freaking out. Makes perfect sense. The fact he has hearing aids, of course. He's been through like crazy shit with big explosions and all that kinds of crazy stuff. Of course he has fucking hearing aids. So these type of consequences and him dealing with like, just seeing how like rugged and like, dude, I'm fucking done. Like even when he's in the LARPing event or whatever, and he has to go do the thing.
He's like, I fought Thanos.
I fought fucking Thanos, man. And he's like just doing all that stuff. Like, of course. There is one little weird thing. How come he gets recognized all the time except when he's trying to sneak the suit like back? Like he goes to the firefighter thing. Is it just a hood? The hood does it.
I guess. It's a hood, bro.
I guess.
I'm shocked that he didn't just put a ball cap on in the shades and like the classic MCU disguise. Yeah.
And he's still got the earpiece everywhere because he's talking to his wife. No phone in hand. Just got the Avengers earpiece, baby. Got the Avengers earpiece. So that's a little weird stuff. But seeing like stuff like when he goes to the bathroom and he's taking a piss and they vandalize Thanos was right on the thing and he's like,
and it's weird because he's on Broadway, like he's at the Broadway.
Yeah.
And they're just letting vandalism like that chill in a Broadway bathroom.
hey, this is post-snap, baby. The world's shit, bro.
I guess that's the only acknowledgement that I get in the whole film that the snap happened. But
yeah, of course there'd be people saying that Thanos was right. And then he's just sitting there
Well, that's like the whole plot. That's the whole plot of Captain Falcon and Winter Soldier. Yeah. Like, that's the whole plot. Is that like maybe Thanos didn't worst decision.
Yeah, maybe he was on something.
Like, that's the whole thing.
Especially you see some stuff in Eternals where you're like, well, I don't know. Maybe he helped. I don't know. But anyway, so yeah, there's all that. And then I just think it's really fun. Like, it's just fun.
It's fun.
It's enjoyable. I like Hailee Steinfeld. I think she's cool. I like Pizza Dog.
I will say the only problem I have with Hailee Steinfeld right now, or her character, Kate Bishop, is it's a little overly too fangirly.
Yeah, but she has no dad. She has daddy issues.
Yeah, I guess you're right.
She has daddy issues. And he is Hawkeye, her who she's idolized since her dad died. That was like the day her dad died was that. So to me, that's what I viewed it as. It was like her having daddy issues. So she was like, what are you going to teach me? What are you going to do?
Yeah.
Because it's like, oh, I don't have a dad. Which is probably going to come up later where he's like, I can't do this. And I bet that might cause conflict with his daughter too. Maybe he misses Christmas and she's like, she comes up and he brings Kate Bishop and she's like, who the fuck is this? You can't be here for your real daughter, but you can be here for Kate Bishop. That might cause some stuff. I'm glad we got introduced to Echo. That's who that is.
Yeah.
The villain.
That's Chance.
Yeah, so she's going to have her own show. Which, in the comics, she starts bad and turns good. So that might be happening here, why she's getting her own show.
I know I'm nitpicking a lot on this. I thoroughly enjoyed it. But I'm having that problem again where it's like there's too many bad people.
Mm-hmm.
Like there's a lot of people who could be like the bad guy here.
Yeah, like Echo, and it's starting the Russian guys.
Yeah, you got the tracksuit, the Echo,
maybe
the Afron stepdad guy. Dude.
Yeah.
It's just like there's a lot of
threads
and like,
but the good thing about the show, which I think is this was probably the best decision for the show, six episodes. We watched a third of it already, so I think that was probably a really good decision for the show. I'm enjoying the jokes. I think they're landing. I'm enjoying the Marvel Christmas remixes. In the part where she's sneaking through the wine cellar, it's a Christmas song with a Marvel remix.
Turned
suspicious, and I was like, that is clever.
I agree. The music is good. It's the Christmas part of it doesn't feel tacky.
No, it doesn't.
It's just like a side thing.
That's the best part of it.
That's like oh, that's why Hawkeye's in New York.
He's
spending Christmas.
And it's like an artificial timer. You know, you got 3 days to get back before Christmas.
Yeah, you gotta spend Christmas with your family. You're on the time limit.
I think, I was really worried because they marketed it was like the all I want for Christmas. They made Christmas like the big deal. And this feels like a movie that's just set in, just like Spider-Man is a Thanksgiving film. It's kind of what this feels like. Christmas is happening, but like that's not.
It's just secondary to everything.
I'm excited to watch more because I like the direction they're taking Clint's character. I'm liking, you know, getting Kate Bishop. Are we setting up the Young Avengers for the future? Who knows? Maybe. I don't know. Kate Bishop being there. I thoroughly enjoyed it. And the fact that there's only four more episodes, I think is perfect. If you tell me there's eight more coming down the line, I'm like, oh, I don't know, man. It might be a little long in the tooth.
But I feel like you can wrap it up pretty quick.
40-minute episodes, four more. I think we're doing pretty good.
I think as long as they don't try and introduce too many more characters to it, I think it's going to be fine. Because I don't like when you're like – that was my biggest problem with Falcon and Winter Soldier was
all that there were all the threads,
so many things being introduced.
Yeah.
You had Zemo, you had Agent Carter, you had
that dude,
the main villain.
Yeah, the dude who became Captain America. I can't remember his name.
Agent USA, US Agent, US something Agent, like that.
But whatever his real name.
There was just too much going on.
Yeah,
Loki was good because it focused on a core group. WandaVision was great because it was just WandaVision.
We'll see what happens. I think we will. I think it'll end up being like the stepdad's the villain. And I think Echo and the Tracksuit Mafia will turn good, mainly because of their jokey nature.
I just don't see... I will say right now, I don't know where it like ends.
Yeah.
Like, what's the...
What's the end goal?
Yeah, what's the villain goal here?
Yeah, I don't know. We'll have to see. Mm-hmm. I don't know. But yeah, I do like the... I like the... Don't kid. I know you're kidding. It took me a while to get this warehouse, man. You know, the land is all for... It's all being converted into lofts. Like, I think those guys will turn into good guys and help them. That's probably what's going to happen.
Maybe.
Also, it's really fun. They're just called the Tracksuit Mafia.
Yeah.
That's fucking hilarious.
It is good.
That's so good.
But it's clear that they've been existing for, like, 10 plus years.
Yeah, she's like, man, the Tracksuit Mafia guys. And the wife's like, them dudes again?
Mm-hmm.
He's like, yeah. But the fact that they're so tacky and weird makes me be like, if you were Ronin, how the fuck did you not annihilate 10 dudes?
Why are they still around?
He's like, I came here to talk to your boss. What do you mean we captured you? I mean, he just buzzed his hands out. It's really nice. I'm excited to see where it goes.
Yeah, I enjoy it.
Yeah, and then the fact that we're just getting a little chillax break to go into the gargantuan event that's going to be Spider-Man. I'm kind of here for it.
Do you want to talk about the operation to get the tickets for Spider-Man?
Oh, my fucking God. We got so lucky that Regal servers were fucked all night so I could get the tickets in
the
morning.
Did they go up like right around when you were checking them?
I don't know when they got up, but when I went in, only 8 tickets had been sold in the middle.
So you got, like, oh, you had to get lucky. Because exactly. I was checking it at about 2 a.m.
Yeah, Adrian was checking AMC at 3 a.m. Mm-hmm. And because she had like set like an alarm or some shit so mm-hmm. she could check it.
And it was still down.
And yeah, no, she managed to get in, but it was like a 3-hour online
queue
to get in.
There was a
and
queue to get in.
7:30 and like 7:45 and 8 o'clock were all sold out. We could only go at like 4:45 or some shit. And there was bad tickets. Yeah. And it was only
we got the exact tickets we wanted too.
It was only, the so only was availability nice. Was 6 seats in the front left.
Hmm.
Yeah, fuck
gross.
That. Yeah, fuck that. So I got us a nice. Not middle seats, but middle going this way yeah. and a little to the left. So that was the best I could do.
I mean, that's solid. I heard horror stories on the internet of people not being able to get in.
Still surprised, though. I thought we were going to be fighting, like you said, I thought we were going to be fighting yeah. for good seats, not fighting for seats at all, which this makes me hopeful.
Like,
for the
let
future
me,
of theaters.
Let me pull up Regal right now. I wonder how bad it is because we're going Thursday night, right?
We're going Thursday night.
Let me see here. Spider-Man No Way Home.
You gotta hit the if you hit the location and then you hit the IMAX. That's the only way you can get to the 16th. Otherwise, it tries to make you buy on the 17th.
Well, even if I'll look at the 17th. Why my thing's being weird?
Maybe so. You let's just say off. We're gonna add
one ticket. Are you looking at Thursday?
I'm looking at our same thing. Yeah, see, it's starting to fill up.
Yeah, you gotta get close to the screen.
Yeah, see, we're right here. This is us right here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, right here.
Okay. Whoop,
pretty good seats. It's like the best I could do. At the time, like these.
That's about where we were sitting during Encanto.
Yeah.
So
just, I would like to be more towards the middle, but I think that's okay.
Listen, we'll take it. We're in. We're gonna get to see it Thursday
yeah,
night.
Yeah, that's nice. But the fact that the movie theater is like filling up, that gives me hope for the future of theaters.
Yeah.
Like, I'm excited. Like, okay, we can have a big movie event.
I think it was only like this because they advertised it as like,
yeah,
this is when the tickets are gonna go live.
Yeah. This also.
And then everybody started panicking.
I'm happy for Nolan, Chris Nolan, because like, dude could not survive without theaters.
Home oh no.
Theaters to make his movies for sure.
Oh yeah.
So
has to be a spectacle for him.
Good. But anyway, we'll see. Anyway, that's it. You can normally write in to reader mail, or not reader mail, to synceduppod@gmail.com or the reader mail
submission
tab.
Nothing coming out this week?
Oh, yeah. The Diary of the Wimpy Kid animated thing comes out this week. That's it.
Is that Disney Plus?
Yeah. Yeah, I don't really care. There's like some weird Benedict Cumberbatch movie I never heard of and like some other movie I never heard of. But anyway, so yeah, go ahead. Reader mail, submissions tab of the Discord or synceduppod@gmail.com with any questions, comments, or concerns, and we may read those on the show. You should also consider following on Patreon to patreon.com/syncedup for $5. You get access to the post show that we're about to do
right now.
So for everybody who did that, we'll see you in a few minutes. Everybody else, we'll see you guys next week.
Goodbye.
Goodbye.